Bernie Sanders, a senator from Vermont, who has built his entire career on fighting for civil rights and equality for all people, regardless of their race, class, sexuality, identity, or beliefs, has done what few candidates could do. He's brought a bit of class consciousness to millions of working-class Americans and inspired them to rally together and fight back against the oppressive systems of power and oligarchical hierarchies that have been used to keep them poor and powerless, all while the wealthy continues to siphon more and more away until nothing is left. True awareness of why the average American has struggled more and more just to make ends meet and survive now spreads like wildfire throughout every nook and cranny of the populace, and the people as a whole have now begun to realize that certain narratives being spun by the government and media about the reality of our current economic and societal distress and the enemy behind it all are completely false. Boogeymen like socialism and the terrifying Bernie Bros are used to try to smear Bernie and quell the ever-growing movement behind him. Politicians tell stories of how status quo politics are what will truly save the country and that people like Bernie are just too radical for us right now. Despite that being a dog whistle to call for the preservation of the wealthy class instead of doing anything that actually remotely helps the people, and despite the fact that boomers and older voters are more easily manipulated by propaganda that fearmongers about the things that would actually benefit society as a whole, more and more fingers are pointed at Bernie, and he's accused of dividing the party and unnecessarily attacking Democrats, as if being even remotely honest and saying, hey, so-and-so is doing a bad thing, is in itself a bad thing. I'm sure they're not just doing it to silence their critics. Nah. But amidst all of the turmoil surrounding the progressive wing of the party, another Democratic candidate is positioned as the only one who can actually win, even though said candidate would do nothing more than fight for the same old laissez-faire capitalist policies and destructive worldwide imperialist conquests. This candidate is also wildly out of touch with the vast majority of Americans due to being wealthy and completely uninterested in why so many Americans are actually struggling. Because doing so would mean taking a critical eye to the very system that put them in power, and obviously they're not gonna bite the hand that feeds. Progressive voters recognize that this candidate is being used to crush Bernie at all costs, and the DNC itself continues to be more and more blatant about their willingness to rig elections and rip the nomination out of Bernie's hands if that's what it comes to. It's a dire situation that exposes the corruption in every corner of our governments. And if you didn't know any better, you might have thought that up to this point, I was talking about the 2016 election. Wrong. It's 2020. And as we speak, we are witnessing a repeat of the exact same events that happened during the 2016 election, except this time, the DNC and neoliberal establishment are now the most brazen they have ever been in trying to stop Bernie. Media pundits and the more centrist Democratic candidates all continue to spout the lie that progressive policies are too radical, even though A, they would be considered center or center-right in literally almost every other country in the world, and B, a majority of Americans actually support things like Medicare for All, a living wage, the legalization of marijuana, free college and student debt forgiveness, paid family leave, the breaking up of big banks, and so on. What's truly egregious is that staffers within the DNC have openly said they think measures should be put in place to essentially steal the nomination from Bernie through the use of super delegates, which are party leaders and elected officials who have the power to override the will of the people should they rock the boat a little too much, and cast their own vote for their preferred candidate in what's called a brokered convention, which occurs if no one candidate gains the majority of delegates in the first stage of the Democratic primary. All to maintain power and the facade that our current electoral process is in any way, shape, or form truly democratic. Every single Democratic candidate besides Bernie said they didn't have a problem with this, which proves that a vote for any other candidate besides Bernie means allowing the establishment to continue waging class warfare, manipulating the people into voting against their own interests, ignoring election laws and the laws in general, and strengthening their hold on us. And what we should all be cognizant of is how organized the establishment is. Every time Bernie gets a leg up, they strike back by launching new rounds of attack ads, amping up their own misinformation campaigns, and bringing out the big guns to endorse their candidate. Whenever Pete Buttigieg, Amy Klobuchar, and Beto O'Rourke all dropped out within 24 hours of Super Tuesday, this was a sign that the neoliberal class was coalescing around Biden in an attempt to boost his performance. And sure enough, Biden ended up winning a majority of Super Tuesday states. But wait, hold up. Biden is clearly sundowning. He's less and less coherent as time goes on. He's deliberately being kept off of the debate stage and out of the public eye. And he also has a disastrous track record of voting for NAFTA, the Iraq War, the Patriot Act, the War on Drugs, the Wall Street bailout, the 1994 crime bill, and the repeal of Glass-Steagall, as well as opposing legal marijuana, abortion rights, Medicare for all, free college or student debt forgiveness. He voted to cut Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, and also has a long history of sexual misconduct and racist, homophobic, and sexist behavior. Is support for him truly as genuine as it seems? It is a bit fishy that his campaign was, let's be honest, tanking before Super Tuesday. But the moment these endorsements happened, suddenly the media is proclaiming him as the strongest candidate and clear frontrunner. Even though Bernie broke the record for winning the most states at the beginning of the primary season and was building more and more momentum as time went on. And something that added to the already massive firestorm of drama around the election cycle was Elizabeth Warren's decision to drop out, her subsequent appearance on Saturday Night Live, which we will get to in a second, and her interview with MSNBC in which she said, referring to Bernie supporters who are engaging in online harassment campaigns, that we are responsible for the people who claim to be our supporters and do really threatening, ugly, and dangerous things to other candidates. Before going into whether these Bernie bros were and still are a clear and present danger, it should be noted that the demise of Warren's campaign could be seen coming from a mile away. Early on, she did establish herself as the first person to run in the 2020 election. She did build her campaign on seemingly progressive policies. She promised to take on the billionaire class and corporations. She vowed to not take money from super PACs. And she was a clearly talented and formidable public speaker and debater. So, what went wrong? She little by little backed off of her campaign platforms and began to attack Bernie, even though they shared a similar base of voters. When she took one of Sanders' quotes out of context and essentially implied that he said that he didn't think a woman could run for president, and was then revealed to have actually taken money from super PACs, mass infighting among Warren and Bernie voters began, and we all began to question whether or not she could truly be trusted anymore. The fact that she came third in her home state should make the answer to that pretty obvious. She was no longer a viable candidate. She had no path to the White House, but from underneath the woodwork came all kinds of wild accusations against Bernie, all tinged with the same toxic identity politics-soaked rhetoric that was used to support Hillary in 2016. Things like, as a Warren supporter, I probably align more with Bernie politically, but I've been so turned off by the behavior of his supporters that I just can't support him. What we tolerate defines our character, and Bernie has tolerated horrible behavior. Even though he literally said he doesn't consider those people to be part of his movement, but okay, cool. It's good to know you'll sacrifice your ideals, throw millions of people under the bus, throw affordable healthcare and more out the window, all because someone was mean to you online. Let's just forget that the UN World Health Organization and international human rights law define the right to health as a basic part of human rights. But yeah, some great principles you have. Bernie supporters were also accused of forcing Warren out early, even though it was clear that her campaign was tanking because she wasn't connecting with voters. And tweets like, "The most qualified human to ever run for president dropped out today because our country doesn't like women," flooded our feeds for days afterwards. Just fucking hell, y'all. Yes, America still has a sexism problem. No one is denying this, but Warren didn't drop out just because she's a woman. God, these people are so disconnected from reality, it's actually unreal. But to the subject of Bernie followers harassing others online, it is certainly happening, but not to the extent that mainstream media or Warren would have you believe. And Bernie supporters like myself have said over and over again that these people do not speak for the majority of us, and that solidarity and reaching across the aisle is incredibly important to us, especially those of us who are already a bit more radical politically. In an article for Salon, Keith A. Spencer said, "To say a single candidate's follower was mean, therefore I don't support this candidate's policy regardless of their actual political implications, is a rhetorical fallacy. It is a reactionary mistake to oppose a candidate who represents a set of specific political positions poised to help or harm different social classes on the basis of another individual's behavior." He then goes on to say, "A video went around of an Elizabeth Warren supporter accosting two Sanders fans at the Iowa caucus, yet it didn't get a lot of play because it didn't reinforce existing stereotypes that we have about Warren's supporters. The media intentionally insulates every candidate besides Bernie to maintain the narrative that he's the only one stirring up hatred and division, and that his supporters are completely unruly and irrational, which by every single metric is completely untrue. There are bad eggs in every bunch, and it isn't the responsibility of a public figure to control the actions of all of their followers. Not only is that an unreasonable demand, it's literally impossible." But one thing I think is fairly reasonable is that even if you disagree with a public figure or politician, you should still treat them like a human being. Which brings me to the absurd reaction to Warren deciding to appear on a Saturday Night Live skit. It's utterly bonkers to me how batshit some of y'all are going just because she decided to take some time for herself and do something fun after what I'm sure was an absolutely grueling campaign. Like, listen, I have profound disagreements and issues with Warren, like a lot of y'all do, but she isn't the enemy or slacking because she appeared on a TikTok skit. I've seen tweets saying things along the lines of, "People are dying because they can't afford healthcare, but it's nice that you had the time to dance for a skit instead of actually helping people." What the actual fuck is wrong with some of you? Also, are y'all really attacking Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez for getting a kick out of that skit? Really? We're going to cancel her because God forbid anyone should have any fun in their lives. Y'all must be really fun at home. But I do agree that Warren has now placed herself as an obstacle to the progressive movements. She has yet to endorse Bernie or Biden, and Twitter is overflowing with the hashtags of Warren to Biden and Warren to Bernie as her base completely splinters over whether or not either candidate is entitled to her endorsement. And personally, I think the more important question is whether she should endorse them. And I saw a comment on YouTube that perfectly sums up my own thoughts. "It really makes you question if Warren is truly progressive if she doesn't endorse Bernie. She still hasn't, even after dropping out, which means she either doesn't care about the progressive platform she ran on for years, or she refuses to do it out of spite because of petty personal disagreements. Either way, it's shitty on her part, and on the part of her supporters for defending behavior that is essentially handing Biden the nomination." And I couldn't agree more. She is a public servant. she was elected to do a duty for the people. So I think in a way she does owe us that. But just because she doesn't endorse your preferred candidate, you should still treat people like human beings. If that by itself is too difficult for you, you should not be endorsing progressive values. You know, we keep seeing this reactionary, entitled, and aggressive behavior on the left, especially within leftist spaces. And even though I myself am a proud anarcho-communist who will happily do all she can for her comrades and family in America and abroad, I'm still going to call this nonsense out when I see it. We're supposed to be better than this. Are we not? Like, I don't know what y'all think harassing and attacking both Warren and Bernie is supposed to accomplish, but did you stop and think that your actions are maybe why there's a vocal group of people online who refuse to support Bernie because of this? When you're fighting for a particular cause, you have to hold yourself to a certain standard and be accountable for your actions. Be an example for your cause and don't succumb to mob mentality. I'm still a firm Bernie supporter and I will happily extend an arm to Warren supporters. We have to recognize that we are all in this together. We're all fighting for similar things. Stop letting yourselves be divided and blinded just because one politician happened to do or say something that you disagree a little bit with. We've got to see the bigger picture, and we've got to find a way to build solidarity across every single community and willingly work together despite our disagreements. Is this an endorsement for Vote Blue no matter who? Abso-fucking-lutely not. But I think it's a call to action to think differently and use a bit more empathy and understanding in your own advocacy. Now, is Bernie going to bring about the proletariat revolution that we so desperately need? His election alone wouldn't. But he's a key building block towards a society that truly works for all of us. And it would set us on the path towards a transitory state in which we would burn down the structure of late-stage capitalism and rebuild things into a social democracy, which could from then on be molded into democratic socialism and then a socialist state and then so on from there. This is our revolution now. Bernie is merely the figurehead of a much larger movement that is going to coalesce into something even greater than we could possibly imagine right now. The establishment is going to throw everything it has at us. At every turn, it is going to try its hardest to divert us. But as long as we stick together and we push back even harder, we will break out of their chokehold and we will succeed. And I'll end the video with something that American Johnson of Non-Compete tweeted. If Biden gets the nomination, from that moment on, he is surrounded by the working class. We never let up. We seize universal healthcare and close the camps and then keep pushing forward. If Trump wins again, the pressure goes straight back to his administration. We keep our movement organized and we keep pushing, not one step back. Don't give up. Don't lose heart. We're going to be all right. Solidarity. Also, fuck the Democratic Party. It's kind of amazing that y'all would happily destroy your own party before you allow the one candidate who would ensure that people no longer die because they can't afford their life-saving prescriptions actually be elected. You'd commit elder abuse and put a man who is clearly suffering from dementia into the White House instead of letting him be at home with his family, all to prop up your own transparent, desperate attempt at self-preservation. Honestly, your party deserves to burn to the ground because you absolutely refuse to stand for a single thing, and over again, you give us the middle finger when we need you the most. I'll sit back and bask in the glow as it all burns down. That's good praxis. And that's gonna do it for this week's video, y'all. If you enjoyed, be sure to leave a like below. If you want to see more content like this from me, hit the subscribe button and ring the bell so you will get notifications for all of my videos. Also, special note for this week, I have opened up an official Instagram account for my channel. You can find me at AliceEvelyn_YouTube, where I will post updates on my videos, my scripts, I'll be posting memes, political discussions, polls, everything related to that. So be sure to give me a follow if you are on Instagram. And until next week, I love y'all. Be strong. Do not lose hope. No matter what, this movement will not be stopped. We have too much behind us now. We're gonna be okay. And I'll see you soon.